and Murat had succeeded in their objective of isolating the entire Allied right flank from the dramatic events in the center. Napoleon surveyed the situation at midday and was entirely satisfied with the state of battle. In addition to Murat's and Lannes' achievements in the north, Marshal Soult held the recaptured Pratzen Heights, while to the south, on the beleaguered right flank, Marshal Davout had stood firm against the mighty initial Allied advance. Only unimaginable misfortune or a miracle could prevent the French army completing a famous victory. For the Allies, a final hope of redemption remained in the shape of the elite Russian Imperial Guard, whose highly trained troops, eager to battle, still lay in reserve. It was about 1 o'clock that these precious troops, comprising some 3,000 men, were hurled in desperation upon the tired men under the French general, Vandamme. The Russian grenadiers were able to break through the French front lines at the point of the bayonet, but were repulsed by the murderous fire of the support divisions. Wearily, they were forced to effect an orderly retreat towards Krenovich to regroup. Almost at once, the last remaining Allied reserve of the Guard cavalry made a determined and ferocious attack on Vandamme's left and rear. Reforming behind them, the grenadiers of the Russian Guard joined in with a renewed attempt on the French front lines. Finally, this concerted pressure achieved its aim, and the French lines began to waver, scattering the battle-weary troops in all directions. Desaguieres remembered the scene. The unfortunate fellows were quite distracted by fear and would listen to no one. In reply to our reproaches for thus deserting the field and their emperor, they shouted mechanically, "Viva Emperor!" while fleeing faster than ever. However, the rest of the Allied force were quite unable to take advantage of the Russian Guard's success. Napoleon redirected 5 squadrons of the Mamluks from his own Imperial Guard to rescue the situation, and despite a fierce and bloody battle, the initiative was regained by the French. The Mamluks, in keeping with their fine tradition, fought ferociously. Captain Coignet recalled their famous charge.
Ces Mamluks étaient de formidables cavaliers. Ils pouvaient tout faire avec leurs chevaux. Ils décapitaient un homme d'un seul coup de leurs sabres courbes. Oui. Et leurs étriers pointus déchiraient les reins des hommes qu'ils rencontraient. Mais il y eut une confusion qui dura plusieurs minutes. Tout était pêle-mêle et personne ne savait qui avait le dessus. La garde impériale russe était composée d'hommes gigantesques qui se battaient avec l'énergie du désespoir, et pendant un quart d'heure, la lutte fut terrible. On ne voyait rien, non, à cause de la fumée et de la poussière. Mais nos grenadiers revinrent vainqueurs et reprirent leur position derrière l'empereur. Le général Rapp revint couvert de sang, ramenant avec lui un prince. Un cavalier vint à 3 fois apporter à l'empereur un étendard russe. La 3e fois, l'empereur voulut l'arrêter, mais il partit précipitamment et ne revint plus. Non, il gisait sur le champ de bataille. Oui.
At 1 o'clock, the survivors of the Russian Imperial Guard retreated in disarray, leaving behind them the Allied center completely destroyed. All that remained now was for Napoleon to turn victory into a rout. And at 2 o'clock, the Imperial Guard, Marshal Soult's divisions, and General Oudinot's grenadiers were ordered to drive south toward Telnitz and the forces still fighting under the Russian General Buxhauden. At the same time, the cavalry of Marshal Davout swept into attack from the west. Buxhauden, completely cut off, with no orders from Allied High Command, issued a desperate order to split his force. His left wing retreated eastward, while the main body attempted to counter-strike to the north. But these were futile attempts, for the troops were soon overrun and forced back towards the frozen lake, Sachan. The Frenchmen, in no mood to show mercy, pursued their beaten foe ruthlessly. General Thibault noted afterwards, "Up to the last hour of the battle, we took no prisoners. It would not do to run any risk. One could stick at nothing, and thus not a single living enemy remained to our rear. Marshal Davout's order to his troops was equally ruthless. Let not one escape. And so, a scene of the utmost horror unfolded, as thousands of terrified Allied troops and horses desperately attempted to escape from their relentless pursuers across the frozen lake. Napoleon ordered his cannon to pound the ice, which broke into pieces, plunging screaming men and horses into the freezing waters. Contemporary accounts claim that upwards of 10,000 Allied troops met a terrible end in this way. Subsequent evidence suggests that the actual numbers were considerably smaller, perhaps 3,000 and 30 cannon with their horse teams. But even so, it was a horrific end for so many brave men. Far away from the scene of this carnage to the north of the battlefield, the final moments of the battle had arrived. By 4:30, General Bagrasio had managed to extricate his men and retreat far enough from the exhausted French troops to allow hostilities to cease. Within the hour, the remainder of the field fell silent, and the Battle of Austerlitz was over. What had begun as the great Allied opportunity to finally defeat and destroy Napoleon Bonaparte had ended not only in their own defeat, but in catastrophe. The Allied casualty figure revealed the extent of the disaster which had befallen them. Over 15,000 troops had been killed, 12,000 more taken prisoner. In stark contrast, the French lost 1,400 men, with 573 captured. Major General Stutterheim looked back on a terrible day.
Am 2. Dezember fand ein verheerendes Gemetzel statt. Die österreichischen Truppen waren sehr verbissen und einfallsreich. Die Russen kämpften zu Anfang sehr tapfer, und die Garde und die Ulaner zeichneten sich durch besonderen Mut aus. Die französische Infanterie manövrierte mit kühler Präzision, kämpfte mit Mut und führte ihren kühnen Zug mit vereinten Kräften durch. Nach einigen erfolglosen Bemühungen gerieten die russischen Bataillone ins Wanken. Die Folge des unvorsichtigen Verhaltens und ihrer zweiten und dritten Kolonne war Verwirrung und schließlich die vollständige Niederlage. Sehr viele Russen waren getötet und verwundet worden, ganz zu schweigen von den vielen Vermissten, die in einer solchen Situation immer unvermüdlich sind.
And so Napoleon had completed a famous victory, a total triumph, which revealed to the world his military genius. Austerlitz had been a tactical tour de force, a battle which had been fought at a time and a place of Napoleon's choosing, a fight which had to some extent been won before a shot was fired. It had been a masterly illustration of the art of turning apparent total defense into devastating all-out attack.
The Battle of Austerlitz was one of the greatest and completest victories that Napoleon ever achieved. Not only did it win the campaign, in fact it won the war at one major stroke. There is no doubt that this battle left Napoleon the master of southern Central Europe.
The Emperor had deceived the Allies completely, and they had rushed headlong into his carefully laid traps. The enormity of the defeat on the field, however, was as nothing compared to its consequences. The following day, December the 3rd, Austria sued for peace, while the beaten, battered Russians limped away to the safety of Poland and Hungary, a thoroughly demoralized army. Napoleon had indelibly stamped his mark on the affairs and fortunes of Europe, offering an ominous portent of the bloodshed which would blight the continent for the next 10 years. Above all, it established the reputation of the Grande Armée as the most effective fighting force of its age. At the end of the Battle of Austerlitz, Napoleon conveyed his satisfaction in a letter to the Empress Josephine. It read, "I have beaten the Austro-Russian army commanded by the two emperors. I am a little weary, I have camped in the open for 8 days and as many freezing nights. Tomorrow I shall be able to rest in the castle of Prince Kaunitz, and I should be able to snatch 2 or 3 hours sleep there. The Russian army is not only beaten, but destroyed. I embrace you, Napoleon.